Bring Your Mind Sparkle series this Sunday also. It's a weekly online platform for discussions on various subjects. Those subjects which matters for your career, those subjects which matters to shape your leadership of ideas, to shape your thought leadership, and to shape your wide variety of interests so that you can be regarded as a person who is well versed in all fields, all sectors, which dominate headlines, which dominates your thought process, which dominates every aspect of society. So this Sunday, we have a very interesting topic. The topic is very unusual, unconventional, which you may think at first is not related to your career. But believe me, this is one of the areas in which very few would tell you about. Very unknown field, but a very widely respected field. The field of book publishing, the field of authorship, the field how to get your thoughts to the world. In fact, your leadership of ideas or your thoughts are in your mind. So many things. But until unless you don't tell it to the world, you do not show it to the world, that remains only a thought, a dream. So your thoughts and ideas are not your own sole property. Let me tell you, if Einstein and if Newton would have thought that their thoughts are their own, things would not have progressed the world which we are seeing. Your intellectual property is not your intellectual property. It is the property for the society, for the world to benefit. This is how the civilization moves on. This is how one epoch transforms into another epoch. If a steam engine would not have been created, we could not have come to this artificial intelligence stage. One complements the other. So taking these ideas further, before I start, I will give you one or two examples and then I will introduce a very key accomplished personality we have with us today. We are lucky to get her on Dashera. And before I start, I wish like to wish everybody a happy Dashera. What a blessed day to start this series on authorship and books. And before I begin, I tell you, every religion in this world always has one divine book. They always say that there is a book which is divine to them. So you can understand the importance of book in the culture of human civilization. No civilization can say they don't regard books. Book is the repository of knowledge, ideas, your creativity. So likewise, God also says that we will write your destiny. He never says that I will read your destiny or I will announce your destiny. He says you will write your destiny. That shows that an author is such an accomplished person. Even God is an author. He wrote the divine book. He writes your destiny. So think the kind of noble profession you would be going into the authorship. I remember one story from 12th century AD. You must have all heard about Laila Majnu, the famous love story. And I think Vinita ji, you must be also knowing because you are a mystic. Your book I have already finished and have with me, The 31 Miles. This book I will also delve into before you start. So the author of Laila Majnu is Nizami Ganjavi, the 12th century Persian poet. Before that, it was just a folklore in the Arabian desert. Nobody was actually knowing it in the form of written book. So Nizami Ganjavi was given this job of translating this Arabic folklore into a Persian readership for this Laila Majnu. Nizami Ganjavi was a serious writer, writer of Persian mysticism, Persian prose, into socio-religious and administrative issues. He was a government servant. So everybody said that how can you write a love story of a common boy and a girl and they get all dies in the end, the sad. Nobody will read it. Why you are writing such things? It doesn't behove your personality. But somehow this thing was completely disturbing his mind. He asked so many of his friends, nobody advised him to write this book. Ultimately, he went to his wife and children and asked, this is the final I'm asking, would I write or not? People have given me this project. His wife was in favor of writing and his son, younger son, around 18 years old, he told, you should write it. The world should know the common love story of people. Until unless love is not known to the world in a common way, it will always be elitist. It will always have that elitist feeling which people will not subscribe. You must write it. It's my... And because of his advice of his son and his strong insistence, he wrote Laila Majnu and the rest is history. The world over knows about Laila Majnu. So what I'm trying to tell you is that one book can make history, not because of you, but the thought process. It can create an idea. It can create a whole bunch of civilization around it. So you are one book away from giving a great thought to the world. Do not think that you will be famous. It's just a part. Your ideas are more important. You are not important. Like this book, I remember having read 50 Shades of Love of Elik Shafak. And I can, when I read it, I felt so enchanted and so well-versed with mysticism and Sufism. Every element is here. A search for your soul. This book is highly one should read it. And so what I'm trying to say, it's Vinita Ji's ideas that has percolated. She may or she may not be known, but the fact is that her works and her ideas will definitely make the world a better place to live. So without wasting much time, I would like to introduce our speaker. Ms. Vinita Bakshi is a multifaceted personality. Let me tell you, you cannot bound her into one category. If I say she is an alumnus of Delhi School of Economics, you may have an idea that she is an economist. She will talk about serious issues, GDP and job and loss and factory and graphs, but that is not her personality. She is a social engineer. And by social engineer, what I mean is that she is a social activist who wants to change the society towards a better direction. She speaks for the women empowerment, for the marginalized, for the weakest of the weakest sections. And she champions the cause of women empowerment. She disseminates that information, which makes a woman powerful, a partner with the male in the power structure of the society and the fruits of development. She is a founder member and a leading initiator of She Speaks, a foundation, which has a very wide online presence. Then she is a founder director of Ambra Foundation. That is also a part of social engineering into social cultural heritage. She promotes social cultural heritage in which you can get to know your roots. So she is a social engineer, as I told you, before being an economist. And then comes the real part. She's an author. Author of the fact that she has brought her thoughts into the field of written literature so that it remains forever. And she has written a beautiful book called 31 Miles, which is published by Rupa, none other than Rupa. And I have read the entire book 2 months back. When I read through, I thought that I will invite her to give her some thoughts and inputs into how a person becomes an author. You cannot be an author by birth. You can be anywhere, but you can become an author. She also writes for Bollywood. She has written a narration for a Paharganj film, which is known as Paharganj in 2019. So she is also into script writing and narration. And as you know, this world is now open for authors, Netflix, Prime Video, everywhere they require authors to write beautiful scripts for them in the form of which can be made into a story. So the world is waiting for your opportunity. Unleash your thoughts and let us hear Ms. Vinita Bakshi for how to become an author and how to create a bestseller. Ms. Vinita Bakshi, the platform is yours. Please welcome.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. I'm so humbled by this very warm welcome which you extended, and your being such a, great oratory skills which we've just witnessed. And thank you so much for inviting me to this platform. And hello, everyone. Adab, good morning, and a very, very happy Dashera to you all. It's a great honor and pleasure to be part of Mind Sparkle series. I thank Shahnawaz Ji, IPS Director, Minorities Welfare Government of Telangana, for providing me with this wonderful opportunity of interacting with young minds. I must say, his is a great endeavor to mentor and show direction to the youth of the country. When we passed out from school or universities, such platforms were not there. But I'm very happy that somebody is working in this direction and thinking of this. This is the time in our lives when our inquisitiveness is speaking, and hand-holding of young inquiring minds is a very great service to this great country and its people. It's call of the day, and I'm so happy that, in so many cities and states, people are thinking in this direction that, you know, how important youth leadership is, because we are a very young country and we have a very good youth representation. And that is why it's very important to mentor and show right direction to our youth. So I wish, you have Google Baba, but some kind of personalized intervention, the way Shahnawaz Ji has created, is very, very different. It's more experiential, and there is no substitute for such a kind of a platform. Google bombards you with a lot of information, but sometimes when we are looking for information, we may get lost. There is a plethora of information and we will not know what we opened the Google for in the first place. And, you know, there is an entirely different direction. By the time we find answer to our questions, we are led in a different direction altogether. So one has to be very careful while, you know, surfing. But when you have platforms like this and opportunities like this, where somebody is there to mentor you, you know, with this Mind Sparkle series kind of a thing. So, you know, every session. So he's been inviting very prolific people from various different dimensions and different aspects who enriched you with their experiences and with their skills. My congratulations to you, sir. India has a plethora of remarkable regional literature and many big and small publishing houses. I'm just one book old, so I'm almost nowhere, anywhere. But my experience has taught me how difficult it is to crack this industry, especially if you do not come from a family of writers and authors. I do not mean to discourage or disappoint you, but I'm going to today try and put a very, you know, the real kind of a scenario that exists out there, because it's a very fascinating profession. So many people think that why not, you know, write something, or that is fine, because all of us, we have a book in ourselves. And as Shahnawazji very rightly said, that our intellectual prowess, it doesn't belong to us. It is for the society. So whatever thought process right now we are in, if we document it, if we present it in the form of a book or write it up, so, you know, it covers the country, it covers the century, it covers the you know, the very ethos of the people, what they are thinking, how they are behaving. You know, it is a complete documentation of the society, whether it's a work of fiction or a non-fiction. And in that sense, every piece of literature, fiction, non-fiction, even an article, movie, entire, all your art forms, you know, literal, non-literal, they tend to make it a legacy of the future generations to come. So today, what you are thinking, how you are living, your thought process, your mind process, your behavioral selves, everything. So it is a great idea to pen it down. Do not think about whether it becomes, it reaches that stage where it's a bestseller or not. But as people, it is our duty. We must never give up on documenting our thoughts and ideas. Even if we write a small diary or whatever, we must always write. It's a very rejuvenating kind of an catharsis, and it's a great idea to always keep you rooted, healthy and happy. So you can bring writing into your practice. And as these days we are talking about a lot of mental health issues also because of COVID. So in that sense also, writing is extremely therapeutic. So if you try writing a page or two, you would see that you would resolve many of the issues which were there in your brain. And once you've pinned them down, you will realize that you have a solution right there staring, and you did not even know that solution was there. So even as school children, and even to my own children, many times I tell them that if they are struggling with an issue, they can write the, you know, all the solutions down and then pick the best solution and move on. In any case, now we are all, you know, youngsters are very smart, you know, plan A, plan B, plan C. So in our time, our parents, you know, they always encouraged us, you know, we did not even realize that, you know, when we are writing these solutions down, they are actually plan A, plan B and plan C only. But you know, in the language of, you know, this business language, and in the more articulate sense, you know, because now we have these very fancy degrees, which did not exist 40, 50 years ago, like MBA and all, now we call it plan A, plan B and plan C. So coming back to the original, how to publish and how to create a bestseller. So I will draw an analogy today. So this is the genesis of a book. So difficult. And how to make a book or a manuscript successful or bestseller. So it is a process. It's a journey, my dear friends. And there are a number of factors at play at all stages. So let me divide my session into two parts. Firstly, how to get published. And second, how to make your book a bestseller. I shall keep my monologue short so that there is an opportunity for a Q&A at the end. And you can pin down your questions if you want to ask something specific regarding the publishing. So firstly, how the journey begins, or how the book is conceived, or how a thought or idea is born. It is choosing a topic. It could be a research, it could be trends or vogues. And then your genres, there are multiple genres. You could be interested in documenting the reality of society, which is nonfiction. You could be writing a work of fiction. And fiction today also is known by many, many names. There is urban fiction, there is candy fiction, there is pop fiction, there is romantic fiction, popular fiction, literary fiction, chick lit fiction, drama, thriller, mystery, you name it. And nonfiction is literary, political, subject matter, it could be course matter, it could be issue based, etc. I am going to navigate fiction basically. The birth of a book is akin to the birth of a child. An idea or thought is conceived in the mind. Thoughts keep the mind impregnated. You're writing long hours and there is no respite without writing. So, you know, your ideas, they shake you so much that it becomes compelling for you to write. That is extremely effective and passionate. But if you just say that today I'm going to write and it's a writing practice, that also I would say is the beginning of a journey. That also is a good idea because it will bring you closer to when that stage comes that you become a compulsive writer and very effective writer because you're so shaken, your emotions are so shaken by the compulsive need to showcase or write or reflect what your mind is thinking, what your mind is thinking about the society, or what your mind is in an imaginative state, or you're writing a fiction. But writing practice is very, very important, and so is the habit of reading. So once this writing process, long hours you're writing, and then there'll be a time when a book will be born. And here begins the tough journey of the newborn. You have to cut and polish the raw uncut diamond the way you would a baby or a child. So editing here is a very important, however excellent your command of language might be, or however excellent your articulation of your thoughts, then somebody's writing down their thoughts. Thinking about an issue very passionately. So you have many, many thoughts coming into your brain and you're writing them. And to you, each and every thought is important because you were affected by it. And that is why you picked the pen and you wrote those thoughts. But in that process, sometimes we are going too far from the topic. And sometimes we are repeating our thoughts. We are not conscious of the fact that we are repeating. And we are so much in love with our writing that we lose the sight of being objective or what we wanted to say in the first place. So here, editing plays a very, very important role. A good editor is very important for whatever you may write, even if it's a page, piece of small article you we submit to newspapers or magazines, you can get it edited. So just imagine when it's a novel, it is a very important integral part of a good manuscript that it goes to a good editor, going to the publisher, and then publishing houses also have their teams of editors. They have special editors, fiction editor, non-fiction editor. And then in fiction also, there are many, many categories. You have literary, you have popular, then you have other kinds of even genres. Every information on every page of the book. And it has to be authenticated. It has to be, the sources have to be checked. And then also there is a, because of Google, publishers also fear plagiarism, or they also fear that copying. And that is why it is very important that you get your book yourself edited, then give it to the publishing houses, and then publishing houses also get it edited by their in-house editors. So this, sprucing up process, and then the everything is presented very sharply to the reader. A child needs to be guided and a book needs to be edited. It's duty now, you're going to publisher. So you have to not give up. Don't expect that, however good your book might be, don't expect that you will take it to a publisher and publisher says, wow, you've written a book, come, let's publish it. No, it's not like that. Every publisher today, especially in a country like ours, receives at least 500 to 700 manuscripts in a day. Even lit agents claim to be receiving that many manuscripts, leave aside publishers. So for a publisher, it's a very, very tough call. And book is your labor of love. Book is integral part of your soul. But for a publisher, it's a piece of commerce. It's a commercial entity for a publisher. So for a publisher, it's very important that what is the kind of, so they have big staffs, they pay salaries, they have buildings, they have distribution network. So for them, it's a part of their routine business. It's not part of their soul, it's part of your soul. So however good your manuscript might be, don't expect that publishers are going to jump at it. You have to be very patient. You have to keep going. First, you have to, search the right publisher for your manuscript, because there are certain publishers who would be specializing in fiction. Some do in non-fiction, some do academic. So you'll have to do a little bit of Google research to take your book to the right publisher. Or today, India is very, very open to the idea of lit agents or literary agents. So there are many literary agencies in India, and they also, of course, they are expensive, they take fee, they might insist on re-editing your book even if you have edited, and it is not very easy to get your book represented by a good lit agent either. So, lit agents also have their own, in common parlance, I can say nakras or whatever. So it's not easy to get hold of a good lit agent. So if you get hold of a good lit agent, then some amount of your work is done. So definitely lit agent would take it to some publishing house at least, if not to Penguin or Harper or Pearson or whoever. So you can try. I was lucky. I was fortunate. So both the things can happen. When you're going through a lit agent can get you a very good deal on your book. So, you will gain financially, and he would also guide you on marketing the book, and there are many factors involved. It is not that simple. So it is good in that sense, but you will have to give a part of your earnings to the agent. In the beginning also, they would expect something from the earnings also. But in my case, I also went to a lit agent, but somehow they were kind enough to edit my book. It is one of the topmost editing agencies in the country. I mean, lit agents, not editing, lit agents in the country. So they edited my book. I re-edited my book. I was not happy with the editing. I re-edited my book. Then I gave it to Rupa, and I was very fortunate. They said, welcome to Rupa Authors Club. And at that time, I was also talking to some other big publishers. And then I said, that's it. I felt very fortunate that it happened. But again, then they also got it edited. So it is like mentoring or shaping up, or how a diamond, how many round brilliant cut, you all heard of RBC. So round brilliant cut, it has 56 facets, 56 or 57 facets in, so there are also two theories on it. So which gives more brilliance or scintillation. So every time a book is being edited, whatever you are trying to say to your readers is becoming more focused, it is becoming more sharpened. And also it's very important for you to have a very good working equation with your editor. And also you have to remember, it is your book primarily. You are the author of the book. You have written of the book. So anything which your soul wants to say should not get edited. And your thinking or your imagination or your focus is still maintained in the book even after the book has gone through two or three rounds of editing, as the case might be. So there are multiple reasons that make getting published very, very difficult. Of course, population being one. And then even, I was drawing the analogy with the birth of a child. So even a child has to go to a school. It's a big struggle, admissions, how difficult admissions are. And then identifying a suitable school for your child is a challenge. Then university admissions have another challenge. And similarly, taking your book to a good publisher would be a complete process. It will have its own set of challenges. With every publisher, there will be when you begin the process, you would realize that, you will learn, you will realize, and by the time you go to your second book, you would be much more experienced. Why competition in publishing is more stiffer? Because as Shanavasji also just rightly said, writing has no age. I'm 90 and I decide to become an author. I'm 80, I decide to become an author. Fine, good, I'm open to writing, I can write. And then I'll, of course, pitch for publishing. So for publishing, there is no age. Anyone who wants to publish, people have been known to publish as young as 9. And from 9 to whatever age they want to write, they can write and they can pitch for publishing. So for publishing, there is a competition is very, very stiff. You can begin writing at any age and aspire to get published at any age. Now, let us assume we have crossed the stage and we are published. What next? If you are a celebrity, people already know you and would buy your book happily. If you're a cricketer or a film star then it becomes much, much easier for them because, they will get a publishing house very easy. In fact, publishing houses would be paying them rather money, come write for us. It is that kind of a scenario. And if you're an academic or a bureaucrat, you're familiar with the system and libraries, and you would still ensure that your book reaches somewhere. But what if you're a common man? What if you are not so well integrated into bureaucracy or academics? Where do you take your book? How do you market your books? How do you sell your books? It is a very, very big challenge. Then you have to strategize with your publisher because distribution is very important. Book is written, book is published. So distribution is always publisher's responsibility unless or until you are a self-published author. So these days, because of the publishing hurdles, many, many successful people have started self-publishing because, even for example, I've known some of the best authors in the world who self-published and then they became phenomenal. They won prizes like Pulitzer and all other, many prestigious prizes after self-publishing, and then publishers were running after them. And in our own country also, there's an example, Amish self-published his first book. He was not finding a publisher. And after that, I think Westland, and he is one of the highest grossers in the country, Chetan Bhagat and Amish, they have been phenomenal. The kind of money they invest in the marketing of their books, actually, they have created benchmarks, how to market a book, how to go about the whole process. Now it is extremely SOP oriented. There are now standard operating procedures to how to make a book successful and how to, of course, a book can be a huge investment. A book can be a very, very huge investment, like just like making a good property in a very plush locality. It can be as huge as the investment. But for a common person who doesn't have those resources, you have to depend upon yourself. You have to look for you may or may not have money to afford an editor. You may or may not have money to afford a lit agent. Some publishers may ask you that, and rightly so, because for them, it's a business transaction. It's a piece of your soul, not theirs. For them, it is just like a product. For them, it is just like a bed or a candy or a shoe or a whatever, you know, for a doctor, for when you take your patient to a doctor, for you, it's a family member. It could be anybody, a friend or family. But for doctor, it's just a number. For a doctor, you're just a patient, patient number so and so. So he doesn't empathetically get involved into your life or into your piece of soul, your writing or whatever. So in that sense, it's an extremely, only when you're writing, only that piece of paper, your written piece of paper is your piece of soul. You know, you express something, but once that is written and that has to go out, then it is very, very commercial, extremely commercial. So now what is a bestseller? What would you call a bestseller? A book or a project that is bought by a large number of people is called a bestseller. Some books have sold many more copies than current bestsellers, but over a long period of time. But let's define a bestseller as a book for which demand within a short time of that book's initial phase, initial publication, vastly exceeds what is then considered to be big sales over a period of time. So the moment a book comes, it's a bestseller. So how is that? So I don't know if what kind of a right word to use. So maybe there is a whole process out there to manipulate the sales of the book, to show big numbers online, or to, you know, strategize in a manner that on Amazon you can be seen as, you know, becoming. I don't want anybody to blacklist me. I speak so blatantly and so openly and so fearlessly. Anyways, so there is a whole process on which on Amazon you can come in the bestseller list and stay on that list. It is today, everything is algorithms, numbers. So one has to be a master of numbers and the strategy and everything possible that you can do, that the way you would do for your children. To, if you really want to make a book that bigger thing, that, you know, bestseller or aspire to be in that space. So how do you maintain, now your book is a bestseller, it's showing on an Amazon bestseller list. So how do you maintain it over a period of time? So again, as I was saying, so there are some good examples in India. Chetan Bhagat and Amish are classic examples of good writing combined with good management, promotion, and publishing. So it's a very multi-integrated kind of a strategy, you know. So certain couple of things combine to make a bestseller. So when I do a recap, I tell you again those, you know, couple of things. I've repeatedly said a book for publisher is a commercial entity, and for an author, a part of his or her soul. Ultimately, you have to let go, just as you would let go a child. A book has a destiny of its own. So just remember where that book would reach, what is the destiny of the book, nobody knows. So what is the destiny of your child when your child arrived? You never knew. You never knew you would become an IAS or an IPS or an author or a teacher or would choose to be self-employed or entrepreneur or whatever. So you have to let go. So now, summing total of what I said, I am repeating again. So what is your duty as an author or a writer? Writing well, ensuring good editing, publishing, and then promoting and marketing, which could be a combined strategy from the author and publisher. And I'm always happy and available should you need any guidance or should you want me to ask anything. In the end, I want to conclude by saying there are just, whether it's success of a book or your child or your own success in life or your career, whether you're, you know, aspiring to be a civil servant or an author or a writer or a university professor or UGC exam, whatever, you know, engineering, medicine, self-employed, MBA, CFA, multiple professions. So there are only three thumb rules to success. And what are those three thumb rules? Hard work, and more hard work. That's it. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Shahnawaz ji, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Wonderful.